Okay. Well, once you get set up, I'll introduce you. So I would like to introduce our next speaker, who is Piotr. And Piotr is an independent data science consultant with a PhD in quantum physics from Barcelona. And nowadays he's based in Warsaw, and he's actively developing D-Quantum Game, that's what it's called. And that's what he's also going to talk about today, about a quantum game with photons, tensors and TypeScript visualized. So please welcome Piotr.
Thank you. Okay, so pretty much this is the introduction. And after finishing my PhD in quantum physics, I entered into data science. So I had a lot of chance to interact with data visualization, with programming, with JavaScript. And here it is. Before the talk, I would like to show what's the game about. So you see a few rock, a few carnivorous plants. And when you want to play it, it's more or less a drag and drop game. When you are able to drag and drop elements, rotate them, and make the photon reach the detector. And it's like step by step. But the thing is that it's not only about a puzzle. It's not only about carnivorous plants and rocks with eyes. It's also about quantum physics, in the point that while the game is with some funny elements, everything under the hood is a simulation of a single photon, in this case. To the point that if you want, you can look at the stages. So for example, you can play the next step a few times, and then see the actual quantum state. I know it's visible from this distance, but basically here you can see the quantum state. And of course, you can get all typical quantum and wave phenomena, such as interference. So it's in classical physics, without waves, basically, if we shine light on some window, some parts of it reflects, some go through it, and that's it. But when we are very careful, we can also combine beams. So not only split them, but combine. And at the same time, in this game, we are able to track what's going on. And in each case, the goal is basically the same, so we need to feed all those plants. If this one is easier, if there are more, it's more challenging. And in this talk, I would like to say first, what was the motivation for the game? So why did I create it in the first place? Second thing, what inspired me and other people from the team? And then about the three parts of the project, the game itself, the tensors, so basically the numerics for this quantum game, but also that can be used in any other project, in quantum computing, quantum information, quantum physics, and cats, so various parts of data visualization. And then possibly what's next. So when it comes to playing, well, we can learn things because we are told to do so, but a lot of learning happens by having fun and playing. And it's not only true for people, it's also true for many animals. When they learn how to interact with the world by this cheerful play, which is like a non-committed thing, which is exploratory, which is without serious risks. And the thing is that, for example, when kids learn how to count, they start with apples, with toys. I don't think it's that often that they start with phonemic construction. And I guess only I need to be very deep in mathematics to appreciate that. The same thing is when it comes to classical mechanics. So I don't know if any of you started learning how the world works by the second step. Even if a lot of you are inclined mathematically, physically, or in engineering. So why does it happen? But we think that the only way to learn quantum physics is by starting with linear algebra, complex numbers, etc. Why? Well, I think there are two reasons. One thing is that, well, it's very hard to do it manually. It's like way too small, way too fast. And the second thing is simply there are no tools. Otherwise, I think it's the worst approach for starting learning quantum physics. And well, unless you study physics, this is, so kind of elvish, basically. And even worse, when I speak with people who are not technical and they say, oh, you do quantum physics. Oh, I'm interested in quantum physics. Because could you tell me how to do some quantum healing? Because I'm really interested how I can cure this and that. And they say, well, it's tricky. But though it is actually a very nice book, how some people who were interested in this metaphysical aspect of quantum physics basically set the foundations of quantum information by one misled article. But the error was so subtle that to solve it, basically people had to invent quantum information and quantum cryptography. And my stance is very much like this one, that to the layman, the philosopher, or the classical physicist, a statement of the form, this particle does not have a well-defined position, sounds vague, incompetent, or worst of all, profound. It's none of these. And I think when people think like, oh, like there's something special about quantum physics, quantum mechanics, you cannot understand that, I think it's bullshit, basically bullshit, in the sense that you can say the same thing about any aspect of technology, science, arts, anything, any aspect of life. Yes, to master something you need a lot of time, and then even you know that there are so many things you don't know. But I don't think it's specific to quantum physics at all. I think it's more in that line. But basically, we are not experienced with quantum physics, and it's the only reason why it's hard for us. And right now, like, it's very likely that there will be a lot of need to understand quantum physics, to develop algorithms, to interact with various pieces of technology. And I think it's important to educate people in quantum physics and also to provide tools so that it's easy to learn or at least experience it. And I did a lot of work when it comes to volunteering for teaching gifted high school students in mathematics and physics, ran some bottom-up camps, teaching Fourier transform, teaching various aspects of physics and mathematics. And then at some point decided, okay, why not starting teaching quantum physics as well? And basically, I ran four workshops, two in Poland, two in Catalonia, and each time, it was actual quantum physics, simple because always two or four dimensions, but enough to show things like non-cloning theorem, or enough to show EPR pairs, or quantum cryptography, with all true mathematics, not only hocus pocus or hard waving. But then later I said, okay, well, there are some nice drawings, but they're not mine. Drawings are of one of my students, who basically turned some of my awful drawings on a blackboard into very nice pictures. But then I said, okay, maybe let's don't do calculations by hand. Let's create some kind of Lego block puzzles, or in a way that we can put elements and then later have a computer simulate all physics for us. So, well, I created the first quantum game. The idea was to be able to interact with this world and to have a game which is at the same time simulating actual physics, but also can be approached by people who are not physicists by themselves. And this game, it's, I didn't test it on rats. At the same time, I did test it on various PhD students, high school students, PhD students, and got emails from people from basically all levels of experience in physics. Very often they looked at different aspects of the game, was very happy to provide some kind of environment which was open, like inviting. And then later, quite a few years later after creating the first quantum game, I got an email from Arthur Eckert. Some of you may know the Eckert protocol for quantum key distribution, which is, well, by him. He wanted to invite me to create the next version. So I said, well, why not? And I was given budget for also to hire a few other people, so basically to focus on various aspects, not only to create anything, but to create something which is working, modular, nice, approachable, and open source. Because I believe that this, when it comes to teaching, we should give it to, well, as many people as possible. And we arrived to Singapore, here playing in the Museum of Arts and Science, vandalizing the exhibition. And when it comes to such interactive things, it's not only about doing something that works, not only about writing a piece of software or article that is correct. It's also about creating something which is inviting, visually, UX-wise. So we looked at, we created a Pinterest profile to basically dump all interesting graphics from demonstrations, from games, another design, and also we look at as many as possible diagrams of quantum optic setups, which to get inspiration for both physics but also graphics, and dive into other pieces of education, basically. So, for example, how to present something which is complex in a way which is as simple as possible. Very often still, the barrier of entry is not zero, but sometimes it may be that high just because the notation is horrible, and sometimes maybe much lower. So, for example, here actually it's one of the big inspirations to color code an equation, so that we actually can explain step by step what happens, and reach people who don't know this equation at the point. We started with various concept arts, some went into the game, some not, because also it's a decision what to show, in which way, because it's not wanted to show every possible aspect of quantum physics, only a few of them, and also how to visualize in a way which is simple, which makes sense, which is accessible. And going back to the game, the same one, which I said, one thing I showed was the game, but the other one is encyclopedia. So not only wanted to make the game is playable, but also in a way which is some kind of entry drug into the quantum world. And for example, when you click at the beam splitter, we have, well, the beam splitter as a element in the game, but also we can look at the quantum states and what happens step by step. We can look at this like polar coordinates, Cartesian for complex numbers, or some color coding. We try to gather various materials so that people can approach it, and materials ranging from very, very simple for someone who heard for the first time about beam splitters to materials for people who basically, you know, finish PhD in quantum physics. Gathering the best materials, and also to try to make this bridge between physics and this interactive simulation. For example, it's a beam splitter. Here's a matrix describing its unitary operation, but also in a way which is not like basically a block of numbers, but in a way that we can explore it. We can see complex numbers. We can see what's the input state and the output state, and even what's the tensor structure. So it's without explaining that here we have both directions and also polarization. And it goes basically for any element. So, well, but what's next? Like we, basically in the process of creating this game, it's already playable to some extent, but we want to expand it with more particles, with entanglement, with quantum key distribution, with many worlds, possibly with also electrons, and even a bigger idea to make, to create building blocks to create interactive textbook, basically showing quantum physics, but in a way which is dynamic, which interactive. He has some concept art, say, for more photons. And when it comes to creating data, we try to make it open source, not only in the sense that code is open and is, well, basically random mess, but in a way which is as simple as possible to interact with. For example, when it comes to description of elements, we try to basically put everything into Markdown. And only those pieces of visualization are JSON, which still is accessible enough for people who are not software engineers, but are dedicated educators. I try to add pieces to show that it's real. It's not only, well, cartoon, carnivorous plants, but also their elements, all elements are physical to the extent that you can find them in a real laboratory. The project right now is like basically split in three pieces. One is like the game itself. The second one is the game engine, which is much more general than the game itself. And the third part, which is, well, which we just started, is separating various pieces of visualization so that people can use it in the other projects. When it comes to tech choices, well, basically, like, while most of numerics for quantum physics, for deep learning, and other numerics is on the high level, it's in Python. When it comes to creating things which are interactive, install free, etc., it's basically we have to use JavaScript. There's no other way. At least I'm not aware of. And in this case, I don't know how many of you write JavaScript. 1, 2, 3. Oh, it's like a bit. So it's like, so for me, it's the first bigger project, TypeScript, and for me, it was a day and night difference. All so many errors that can be saved just with types. View, just to make it simple, so that people with various skills level can interact and various levels of, well, programming skills. And, well, especially in these mixed teams, when people there are people who from physics, from design, we need to set very strict norms so that we can collaborate in a way that code quality is good. When it comes to quantum tensors, it's we decided to create something which is much broader than the game itself, so that basically we can create anything. Here's an example of if you had some physics like Hawk or Mandel interference of two photons. But basically, within this model, you can do anything from quantum computing, which is the simplest, to any states which have spin, polarization, direction, many atoms with multiple energy levels. Anything would you like. We are not restricted to qubits only. When it comes to visualization, it's mostly about writing CADs and about writing operators. So states and operators. It's already in the game, but thanks to Unitary Foundry, we also work on creating it as a separate object. It's almost working. Actually working, but just like if I think it's better to release it slightly later with full documentation, everything. But in a way, again, to make it simpler to show quantum states, and no matter if it's quantum computing, if it's quantum information, or it's quantum physics. At the same time, to be able to show operators in a way that we can approach complex numbers and the tensor structure but in a way that is not intimidating. Within the same thing, you can show, I know, Hadamard gates, Synod gates. You can use these pictures for density operators, for mixed states, and basically anything you like to do with quantum physics, or discrete quantum physics. And when it comes to such projects, I kind of don't like it that in many projects, visualization is a second thought. So we create something, then go for the first visualization, and that's it. In this project, basically, we want visualization to be, one of the main focuses. And here, for example, is not some piece of modern art, but explorations of various ways of presenting an array of complex numbers. And this is a lot of trial and error, a lot of testing of people, what is easy, what isn't. But I think like that with these kind of setups, we can go beyond showing operators basically as tables of numbers. And well, we still work on that. It's already playable, so if you like beta testing, it's the ideal time. And of course, if you like to help us, it's also ideal time. Everything is up to date on a GitHub project. And thank you.